Welcome to Creating Accessible Word Documents. This webinar is hosted by NTAC and OJJDP. I'm Donna Patrick, a Section 508 specialist, and today I'm here to talk about creating accessible Word documents. Let's first talk about source files. Accessibility begins with accessible source files. For instance, files created in Word or PowerPoint. PDF files are never created as PDF files. You need some sort of source file, such as Word or PowerPoint, and convert it to a PDF file. Other possible sources are Excel, InDesign, and HTML, but this training does not cover those source files. It is important to fix any potential accessibility issues in the source file before it is converted to a PDF file. These issues must be fixed in source files. Color contrast is easy to fix in Word documents, but difficult or even impossible to fix in a PDF file. Someone with low vision might not be able to discern the foreground from the background. Someone who is colorblind might have difficulty with some color combinations. Make sure that if you use color to convey information, for instance, in graphs, charts, or text, that information is also provided in another way. It is not something easily fixed in a PDF file. These issues must be fixed in source files. Continue. Some aspects of tables cannot be fixed once the document is converted to a PDF, such as header rows repeating across pages or cells breaking across pages. Fix those in your Word file first. Your links must describe their purpose, usually the destination, where the link will take you. It's best to use plain language text over a web address, but if you must use a web address, make sure surrounding context describes purpose. It is important to have a good background to foreground contrast for people who have low vision or who are colorblind. While it is possible to change colors in a PDF file, it is much easier to fix in a Word file. Changing color in a PDF file can create other problems. The WCAG 2.0 specifies a contrast ratio of 4.5 to 1 for normal text, which means that the foreground color must be at least 4.5 times brighter or darker than the background color. Larger text can have a slightly lesser contrast ratio. You should use a color contrast checker tool to calculate the contrast ratio of the foreground and background colors. All contrast tools work on the same principle, but use different codes for the colors. Some can be downloaded, some are used online, and some are browser extensions. Here are examples of poor color contrast and good color contrast. It will be more difficult for someone with low vision to see the example on the left and easier to see the examples on the right. Light blue on white is harder to read than a darker blue. Green and white combinations are all problematic, but you can use a darker green and pass the color contrast requirement. Any shade of yellow and white will fail for color contrast, so use a different color instead, such as brown. If an element fails the required color contrast ratio, you'll need to make some adjustments. If the failure is in an image, you'll need to recreate that image with appropriate color contrast. If it is text, you can easily change the color by using the font color picker, ideally through styles, which we'll discuss later. In this book report, the headings have a contrast ratio of 3.9 to 1, which fails the requirement of 4.5 to 1 for normal text. The largest heading is 6 point, which is within the normal text range. Place your cursor in the text whose color you want to change. In this case, the Level 1 heading. Select the Heading Level 1 style in the Style group on the Home tab. Click the drop-down icon next to the color of the text and select the new color or select more colors to adjust the hue. If you choose to select a color not on the color palette and choose More Colors, another dialog box will open. Select the Custom tab and use the slider to change the hue of the current color so the new color passes the contrast ratio requirement of 4.5 to 1. You can use your color contrast tool right on the dialog box. Then select OK when you are satisfied with the contrast ratio. The text should now pass the guideline. Continue fixing any other color contrast ratio failures in your file. Now let's switch to talking about using color in Word files. It's perfectly fine to use colors in Word files, but color should never be used as the only means to convey information. People who have difficulty distinguishing colors might have trouble telling certain colors apart. Someone who cannot distinguish colors might have trouble telling the quarters apart on this pie chart. This can be fixed by including the data on the chart or using patterns for the different sections of the pie chart. Here are some examples of how color might be used to convey information in a Word file. The correct answer should not be indicated by color alone, as in the case on the left of the slide. Both correct and incorrect are identified by circles, the only difference of which are the colors that will fill the circles. In the example on the right, the symbols are used, a green check mark. The example on the left, the required readings are only identified by color red, whereas on the right, an asterisk has been added to identify required chapters. Asterisks are often used when indicating required form fields. Someone who cannot distinguish colors can see that chapters 2, 4, 5, and 6 are required because they also include asterisks. Back to the pie chart example. The chart on the left only uses color to indicate the amount of sales during each quarter, whereas the chart on the right includes the quarters and percentages of sales during each quarter. Imagine if the chart on the left were printed in grayscale. You'd have trouble figuring out which quarter was which. The chart on the right would be no problem if the chart were printed in grayscale. Another example of using color alone to convey information is when links are presented in text without being underlined or have some other non-color designator. WCAG 2.0 requires that the color contrast ratio of the link to the surrounding text be at least 3:1. So now let's focus on data tables. Data tables can be made accessible to blind people, but there are a few things that must be done in the source file. Note that it will need to be tweaked in the PDF once converted. When working with tables in Word, there are a few things you can do to make sure the table will be ready to be made accessible when converted to a PDF file. The following slides will go into detail about getting your Word table Section 508 compliant. Note that if you use the Draw Table option, your table may not convert to an accessible table in PDF, so avoid using that option. On the Insert tab, select Table, and either use the grid to create your table or use the Insert Table option and type or choose the number of rows and columns your table needs. To insert a table using the grid, drag your mouse over the grid to select the number of rows and columns you need for your table. When you let go, your table will be created. If you'd rather use the Insert Table option, select Insert Table under the grid. A new dialog box will appear where you can either type the number of rows and columns or use the selector arrow to select the number of rows and columns, then press OK. Tables need column headers. Even if none of your tables span more than one page, it is important to set the first row to repeat over pages. That's what tells Acrobat to make it a column header when it is converted to a PDF. Right-click on the first row of your table, if it contains header cells, and select Table Properties in the right-click menu. A dialog box will appear. Select the Row tab and put a check mark in the Repeat as Header Row at the top of each page. Then select OK. Next, we need to make sure that if the table does span more than one page, the rows do not break over pages. This can cause issues with screen readers using tables. It is also more difficult for sighted users to understand the table contents. Select the whole table. This can be easily done by clicking on the plus in a box icon at the top left corner of the table when you place your mouse over the table. Then right-click and select Table Properties again. Select the Row tab and uncheck the box that says Allow Row to Break Across Pages. Then select OK. Let's now focus on links. Links make it easy to access another place in a document or an address on the internet. And there are a few things to consider when making documents accessible. Sighted people can usually distinguish links by looking at them. They are usually underlined in a different color than the surrounding text. While the web addresses or URLs shown in this slide are relatively easy to interpret, not all URLs are so understandable. Including more meaningful text, link purpose, just before the link is better for everyone, but especially screen reader users. The best way to include links in your documents is to make meaningful text a link. Creating a link of text is relatively easy. Highlight the text you want to be a link, right-click, and select Link, then Insert Link. A dialog box will appear. Type or paste your link in the web address field at the bottom of the dialog box, and press OK. Your link will now be an active text link. Making URLs active is easy in PowerPoint. Simply press space or enter after your properly formatted URL, and it will become an active link. We've discussed what must be fixed in source files, Let's now talk about what should be fixed in source files. These items can be fixed in a PDF file, but are much easier in source files, or in case a source file is updated regularly. Anytime a PDF file is edited, it can and often does create additional problems, such as tag content disappearing or links becoming unlinked. Let's begin by talking about headings. Blind people use screen readers when reading documents. By pushing certain keys, they can either go through the document and hear only the headings, or press a set of keys and call up a list of headings. Therefore, we need to make sure proper headings are used, not font effect, and that they are in the correct order. To add a heading, select the text that you want to be a heading. Then select the heading, level 1 through 6, that you want it to be. Documents should have only one heading, level 1, the title, and not skip level. Now let's talk about a related topic. Style is not something most people who regularly use Word know about. Usually a novice Word user changes the look and feel of a document by adjusting the font's type, color, weight, etc. Those changes do nothing to help a blind person using a screen reader software. The Styles section can be found on the Home tab. Select the Home tab on the ribbon to see the Styles group. It is sometimes easier to work with Styles if you expand the Styles group. Select the icon in the lower right-hand corner of the Styles group to expand it. It will then be displayed on the right-hand side of your screen. Applying styles is just like applying headings. Place your cursor on the text and select the style. You can even modify styles if you'd like. The default styles in Word are a starting point, but you can easily change them. Remember the discussion of contrast? There are several default styles that fail the contrast ratio guideline, so be sure to check for that once you've settled on a style you like. To modify a style, right-click on a style and choose Modify. A dialog box will open. In the dialog box that appears, you can change the font color, size, type, which would be the font face, weight, which is bold or not, style, italicized or not, alignment, and other settings. To change spacing, select Format on the bottom left. You know that space between paragraphs and headings in paragraphs? Did you know that it should not be created by a hard return? That results in empty paragraph tags when your Word document is converted to a PDF file, which causes screen readers to announce blank. While they can be deleted in the PDF file, it should be fixed in the Word document. To change how much space comes before and after elements, such as headings, paragraphs, and lists, select Paragraph from list that appears after selecting Format. Now let's discuss images. Images make documents more interesting. Some images are used to convey information, like the pie chart on the right-hand side of the screen. Others are just decorations, like the border image on the left side of the screen. Following are more examples of types of decorative images. The white column and image of children on this slide are examples of images that are decorative. It won't matter if a blind person using a screen reader knows they are there or not. They convey no information and are purely decorative. Important images, on the other hand, are images that present information. A blind person using a screen reader needs to know what is in the image in order to have the same information that a sighted person has. Following are examples of important images. This image is both a linked image and has text. It will need to be described to a blind person using a screen reader. Images of text, except for logos, is discouraged when text can be used instead. However, in the case of organizational charts, such as the image in the slide above, it might be necessary to use an image of text. In that case, the image must be described in full, including the relationships. On the OJJDP website, an organizational chart is used, and it is described in detail on the same page. This combination of graph and vertical bar chart will need detailed alt text describing the data point. Blind people cannot see images, so if it has text, the text should be conveyed to a blind person using a screen reader. Alt text is text that can be read by assistive technology and is usually invisible to the sighted. While adding alt text is easy, writing it can be very difficult. Unless the image is very simple, the alt text should be written by a subject matter expert. A linked image needs brief alt text explaining where the image will take you if you click on it. If there is other text on the image, include that as well, if it seems important. In this image that links to the National Missing Children Day Commemoration website, that must be included in the alt text. Bringing our missing children home safely can also be added. but it is not as important as where the image link will lead. Note that the word link should not be used because a screen reader will announce that it is a link. Organizational and flow charts need not only the text of the chart included in the alt text, but also the relationship. For instance, this organizational chart describes who reports to whom, as well as including all the texts from the chart. It is best if the text is on the page itself, but there is no limit to the amount of characters and alt text in the PDF file. Charts and graphs need extensive alt text, including all data points. It is best if a subject matter expert writes this alt text. Images with text, such as logos, can be given alt text of whatever text is in the image. Note that if a logo is repeated on every page, it only needs to be described once. Now that you know how to write alt text, let's go over how to add it to your Word document. It's easy to add alt text to images and Word files. First, right-click on the image and choose Format Picture. If you have a newer version of Word, you could select Edit Alt Text instead. Select the Layout Properties icon in the Format Picture pane. Expand the Alt Text drop-down and type the alt text in the Description field. Don't use the Title field unless the file will never become a PDF file, because the Title field does not convert to alt text when the file is converted to a PDF file. Microsoft Office has a very comprehensive video on its website discussing alt text. Select the link in the video or access the link beneath this video by selecting Show More. Let's now discuss document properties. While not quite as important as most accessibility features, the document properties provide information about the document and help users of assistive technology, such as screen readers, identify and find documents. This can be filled out in the PDF file, and there are things you will need to do in the PDF file once it is converted, but it is a good idea to get a start in the source file. Select File on the ribbon. The Info view will appear. On the Info tab, select Properties, then Advanced Properties. A dialog box will appear. The title should match the heading level 1 of your document. The subject should briefly describe what the document is about. The author of the document should not be a person's name, but the organization or government department or agency the document is for. For instance, DOJ or OJJDP, not John Doe. The keywords are words that someone might use when searching for information your document might provide. If at all possible, the creator of the document should provide the subject and keyword. We've discussed what must and what should be fixed in your Word file, but there are some accessibility features that cannot be fixed in source files, such as some table properties, document language if the default language of the user's computer is not the same as the language in the file, and list bullets marked correctly when converting from Word. These will need to be fixed once the PDF is created and is not within the scope of this tutorial, but will be addressed in a separate tutorial. Finally, here are some resources that provide more information. Please take a few minutes to review the disclaimer here. Thank you for viewing today's training.